Joy comes in the morning. Welcome everyone to the service this morning. It's a little colder out there, and it's actually nice. Sun's shining, but it's cold. It would be, I think we had 10 degrees driving down here. Roads are not all in that great a shape, but thank you for coming. That would be minus 12 Celsius. So thank you all for coming. This is the time when a lot of people find an easy excuse not to go to church. Thank you for finding a purpose in coming. So let's stand to our feet and pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your blessings in life, truth, and just who you are as a Savior, as a God supreme. You are the God supreme. You are the creator of the world. It's all in you, the Son and the Holy Spirit, the combined, unified body of our creator that we don't really understand completely. We know it's Father, and we know it's the Son, and we know it's the Holy Spirit. And we know the Holy Spirit lives in us. And we know that the Son saved us. And we know that the Father is in heaven. And we thank you for that. Thank you, blessed Father, for the whole entire universe that you've created, that has been created for us to dwell in at this time. Somehow you found purpose in the middle of all the doings and everything that you are and everything that you have to create us and bring us into this world with purpose. Thank you, Father. Thank you for this moment and where you've placed us. We know that there's many troubled places around the globe today as the end is coming closer and closer, one day closer than yesterday. And we know that it continues to be this way. And we know that there is a spiritual pressure that seemingly is out there in the unseen world of evil that is building up. And it's building up in many countries around the world. And we're seeing it. It's becoming very obvious to us. There's a lot of turmoil going on right now. In my lifetime that I can recall, I don't know as that I've ever witnessed, that I can recall, as many countries that have issues going on with each other. And there's a setup happening somewhere in the Middle East and in other regions. And the Bible, your Bible even talks about some of these very countries. And so, Father, we're still protected here in the Western world. You've brought us into this community, into this place, Father, to walk where it's easy. It's easy for us to walk here, but oh God, for those that are fearing their lives moment by moment. We know that there is churches in these countries. We know that there is your people in these countries that are constantly under the thought of fear. And even though I know many of them have found freedom in fear and or through fear. And so, Father, we pray that you would sustain the church and cause the church to grow fast and cause the power of your Spirit to stand up. Because when the day is evil and evil prevails like this, your Spirit will raise up a standard. So we pray that there would be an outflow and an outburst into areas that we've never even heard or even know about. Through people that are mighty and people that you have brought purpose in life to radiate forth your glory and your truth. Father, we pray this. And for us that are here this morning, Father, that even in the freedoms that we have, we are so free, but we find ourselves ashamed many times. And even in the time to worship, help us to come forth this morning and worship you in the power of your Holy Spirit. That your Holy Spirit that is in us would flow out of us and return the praises back up to heaven, that your name would be glorified. We want you to know that we think so much of you, and we think more of you than anyone else in this world. You are our God, and we worship you, and we praise you, and we take this opportunity to do that. We allow it to come out of us by way of song and praise and worship, by bowing, by lifting up hands, by movements that we do even just to worship. And we thank you for that time. We don't have to worry about anybody on the outside of the building that is wanting to break in and destroy our service, except the devil and self. And we stand against the devil in the name of Jesus, and self we crucify. in the name of Jesus, so that you might bring out of us your desire, Father, so we worship you. Be with every facet of the service, through worship, through prayer, through Sunday school teachers, through Brother Steve's message, and through
Jesus
everyone else that has something to
crucify.
Do. May you be glorified.
In the name,
forever we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. It's often interesting when you pray, you kind of like hear the thoughts of heaven, and then you pray that out. And it's sometimes very interesting where the Lord takes you in prayer. It's such a direct fellowship, so direct. So, hallelujah. So this morning, thank you all for coming again. And like I said, it would be a morning that would be easy to find an excuse not to come. The roads are slick and it's cold, but yeah. I remember as a young boy walking through snowdrifts that came up to my waist, close to my waist at times. We would never miss church. It was just the way it was, but we walked. And the drifts were this high, but that's about as tall as I was. So we say that we used to have a lot more snow when I was young. You know, it came up to your knees all the time. Yeah, but your knees were this close to the ground. So that all has changed. Hallelujah. This morning we're starting something new. We're doing something that was announced, and it was actually something that for the Batanya people that are watching this morning, we love you, Batanya. We love you, Mark, over in Saudi Arabia and all the other parts of the world that are watching, perhaps in Honduras, where some of our people are this morning. We love you all so much. But we have something that we've learned and gleaned from them is this family of the week thing that we're wanting to do. And some of you have seen the sheets. It was announced. And this morning it was chosen. And you know, of all days, this man went to church this morning, and he took, I forgot, probably my second most important thing. What's the first important thing? What? Bible. You're right. What's the second important thing?
Glasses.
Yeah. But I'll be able to read it, though. So this morning we have Michael and Arie Weaver and family to come up here, and we will introduce them, and some of the things we read off here. So to show you a little bit and tell you a little bit, exemplify through this morning how that we'll be doing this. So, amen. And next Sunday will be somebody else. Just come right on up here. Come right up here where you're very comfortable. May I say this way, come up. Right up here where your father has stood for many, many years. Amen. Amen. Come on over. That's all right. Michaela, I was telling you that if you're back in the sound room, and I said we'll probably use this mic, but we do have that one too. Should this one be? You turned that one on? On. Okay, so that one will be here. All right. We won't need it a whole lot, but what we'll do is we'll read this off, some of the questions that we have, so you know a little bit who they are, for some of you that don't know. Michael is my son. He's my oldest son, not my oldest child, but my oldest son. And so, how many of you didn't know that? Okay, yeah, he's my oldest son. And my family's kind of written through this. You'll find them out here somewhere. Okay, so here are the questions. Where were you both born and raised? Michael and Arie. Arie is, of course, the wife of Michael, and then they have two children, and one child is missing today in Honduras. That's Brevin. So Arie was born in Millersburg, Ohio, and raised in Mount Eden. Michael was born in Millersburg, raised in Millersburg and Sugar Creek. Where do you live presently? We live just north of Sugar Creek, about a mile and a half, right? On off of Gulf Course Road. How long have you been married? We will be celebrating 25 years in 3 weeks. Yeah, that's a great number. I remember when we were married 25 years. That was a long time ago. Okay. Introduce us to your children. How many names and ages? Brevin is 23 and he works at Weaver Barnes. Michaela is 21, works at Weaver Barnes. And Sarah is 15.5. Almost 16, right? Yeah, there we go. All right. And is a student at Gareway High School. What are your occupations? Michael is a general manager at Weaver Barnes, and Arie works part-time at Payway, which is one of the Weaver companies, doing payrolls. What is your family motto? But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord, Joshua 24:15. What is a favorite scripture verse for each of you? Michael said, commit your works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established, Proverbs 16:3. Arie's favorite verse is, for the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from you, nor shall my covenant of peace be removed, saith the Lord, who has mercy on you, Isaiah 54:10. What brought you to Oasis? And we turn to the next page. What brought you to Oasis? Michael said, I was born here from the beginning, being Wayne's son. And my name is Wayne Weaver. Arie, I was wanting a deeper walk with God and was looking for a church that could help bring me to that place. Question number 9, what do you appreciate the most about Oasis Church? We appreciate the sound teaching we get that goes beyond the surface level. Also, we appreciate the church body and has a passion to serve God in a more meaningful way. Number 10, describe one thing that you really like or appreciate about your spouse. Michael said this about his wife. Excuse me. My wife is an amazing wife. She puts her children and husband's ambitions before her own. She is also a wonderful support and is a very caring person. She is my best friend. Arie's response to that question was, I appreciate his easygoing personality, and he always thinks of others first. He is my best friend, and I love living life with him. Excuse me. I should say something a little bit to this, since you're my son. When he was young, we'd give candy like we do sometimes to children, like you all do. And he would always give it all away. I actually have to tell him, you know, you keep some for yourself. Don't just give it all away. But no, he just, many times, he can't wait to go to church. He wouldn't eat it to give it to his friends. That is still a testimony that you carry, even at work, at the workplace. I don't think anybody has ever had any negative word to say about you as a general manager. I've heard that over and over and over. So, and the people know that you care for them. What person has marked your life in the most positive way? Michael said, my dad. He has been an inspiration to me. Not only did he start the church, he also started many businesses and ventures, and has endured many difficult things in life and has been faithful through it all. Arie says, my husband, he has been patient and kind with me over the years, and he has taught me a lot of being a living example. And now it says, share a short testimony of God's work and leading on your life. Michael, this print now becomes smaller and it's more difficult to read. Would you read your own testimony?
Which mic am I using?
Just use this one, sorry.
Okay. So let's see here. The Lord has been faithful to us. We praise the Lord for his goodness and mercy in our family. We've had some difficult things that we've gone through, and we continue to ask the Lord for direction. The Lord led us not to focus on what we don't have, but rather thank the Lord for what we do have. This completely changes the outlook in everyday life. We felt the Lord lead us into a deeper walk of faith and trusting him even when we can't see ahead. Especially in this past year, we have experienced the goodness of God in so many ways.
Is there anything you want to add to that? No? You've gone through some trials with health issues, Arie has. Amen. And God is good. Amen. I thought a little bit, and I know that it's, I'll just say this, Michael. Through the night, I woke up, of course, and I was thinking, as a young boy, I don't know that you and I ever have had an argument. No. Not even in business. I'm the owner. He's the general manager. I don't know that we've ever had an argument. That's quite remarkable. And you've been a very good boy from young on up, all the way through your life. That's tremendously good testimony. Amen. I would like to pray for the family now, if we could just close our eyes. Father, I thank you for Michael and Arie and Michaela and Sarah and Brevin that is not here. I pray, Father, that in this family you could glorify your name. And Lord, that you would, the impressions that they have left to us and the examples that they have lived among us, that this would spread into that even that next generation, that your name would be glorified and that the power of Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit would be present in all their ways and all their doing. Direct their path, Lord. Direct them as time goes on and as they continue out. Protect them health-wise, Lord. I pray that you would bring your healing power upon Arie that had so many difficulties in the past year. But then, Father, also upon Michael and upon Sarah and also upon Michaela and also on Brevin, Father, protect them. Protect them from evil, protect them from harm and from danger. And may your blessing rest upon this family, Father, that your name would be glorified. We pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you. So what we'll do now is we will turn the time over to worship, and that will kind of take care of, rather than the preacher's thoughts in the morning, we'll do that. And then this will take quite a while to reach around. It'll probably go several years if we do ones a week. So God bless you all and participate in worship. The children then will be dismissed after worship. And so they're going to be here. You know, one thing that I've seen that I've always liked to see, some of you parents are bringing up these really tiny little children and because they want to come up here and worship. That's really special. I really love that. You're teaching them something. You're teaching them worship. Not only that you're teaching them, you're allowing them to worship. Something I did not know about till the Holy Spirit came on my life many years ago. Up until then, I didn't know what worship was, but my hands were up ever since. And so thank you for allowing them privilege to do that as you worship with them as well. God bless you.
I'm shame, myself to blame, I bless your holy name. God spoke out the wind from the middle of my storm. His words of truth brought healing, and my heart began to warm. God, I had only heard of you. My life was built on sand. I see your face so clearly now. On solid rock I stand. In front of me, there's no desire to hide. There is no shame, my heart aflame. I bless your holy name. There is no shame, my heart aflame, I'll bless your holy name.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Here he comes, he is high and lifted up. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Here he comes, in power, strength, and might. Blessed is he who comes. Every He's worthy of all praise, worthy of all praise.
Heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song. King of Kings, you are.
just offer a prayer for the offering that will be received. And Lord God, this morning we thank you. Thank you for your good gifts to us. Thank you for all that you have supplied in giving us our needs and our wants. And beyond that, you have supplied so generously. And I pray this morning that you would receive the gifts that we return to you, that you would be glorified in our midst. Father, that you would bless those who are giving, that you would bless the work of their hands, that you would establish their steps, and that you would give increase. For my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning and greetings in the that wonderful and beautiful name of Jesus. It's so good to be here this morning, worshiping together. As I was standing here, looking out across the group this morning, you know what draws us together here is Jesus. There's a lot of different ways that people gather, a lot of different events that people gather for. Sometimes for sports, sometimes it's family, sometimes it's a lot of different things. But what draws us together Sunday after Sunday is that we have found an answer to our life. We have found one whose blood has washed away our sins. We have found one who loves us. And we come together to worship him. And to praise him. He's changed my life. He's changed your life. And he will continue to change our lives. And it is this. It's our love. He loves us. We love him and we love each other. And we're drawn together in this worship of the Almighty Creator and his Son and the Holy Spirit. That's why we're here today. To gather around him and to worship him. It's not just religion. It's not just a duty. It's love. That's why we're here. God's love. our love to him and our love for each other. So it's so good to be here today and to worship and to praise. My heart was moved. Yes. Oh, thank you. I saw signals. Children, you're dismissed for your Sunday school. I knew there was something. Thank you. Thank you for alerting me to that. All right. Would you stand with me and I'd like to pray. Father, I bless you this morning. I thank you that there is an open heaven, and there's an open heaven because Jesus, because you came. And you came into our world through a door, and you have lived here, and you have experienced what we experience. We can be sure of that. And then you died, and you rose, and you left, and are at the right hand of the Father, and yet you are here. Holy Spirit, you are here, Holy Spirit. And you are here in our hearts, Lord. And we're here to worship you today. And how is it that an almighty God with all power and all might, who has never had a beginning, will never end. You have all power and all authority, and all authority and power comes from you. What can man do? We think we do big things, but we can only do something with what you have already given us. And I look at these things, Lord. I look at the world, and then I look at space. And the biggest thing we can do is maybe a nuclear bomb. And yet that's very small. And somehow in this, your almightiness, you desire mankind. You desire relationship and love. So, Father, I thank you this morning in the way that I can. With my mouth, with my life, we bless you and praise you. And I thank you, Father, for the privilege and the honor of being your child. Father, I ask this morning as I share the word that's on my heart today, that somehow it would just simply minister to our hearts out of your word, by the Holy Spirit, that we can see in a greater way or in a greater manner your desire towards us and ours towards you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. There's a scripture that somewhere in the Old Testament that speaks to in this manner. It says that Jesus is the desire of all nations. And men everywhere are desiring something, and they don't actually realize often what it is. Seeking and looking and desiring. The title of my message today is The Garment of Praise. The garment of praise, as I was preparing for the message and meditating and thinking, this is the first message I'm preaching in 2024. I preached the last one on the last day, the last day of 2023, and so this is the first message I'm preaching in 2024. And my mind was going back, I was thinking back on some things, and I think Brother Burnell in one of his last message kind of stirred my mind along some of these lines. You know, we can look back and we can see what 2023 held. That we can do. Good things, things that weren't so good, things that happened, but that's all past. We're here today, and we're at the beginning of 2024. And we don't know what all this holds in 2024. As Brother Wayne mentioned in his prayer this morning, things are probably more of a turmoil than I've ever seen in my entire life. And it seems like there's a pressure that's building to something. And we don't know exactly what. We know the things that the Bible says. And we don't know exactly what all that entails. However, we do know the one who is in charge and is over everything. And we know what he says in his Bible. So there is a certain confidence that we can have going into 2024 That we don't have to be shaken like those that don't have hope. The worst thing that someone... What did Jesus say? He said, don't be afraid of men. They can kill you. We're all going to die anyway. But they don't have the power to throw you in hell or take eternal life away from you. And it is on this confidence that we enter in into this coming year, if I can say it that way, that I enter in. So we look back a little bit, and you know, as I think, again, I'm going to allude to Brother Burnell mentioned this, and I thought about looking back, because the Bible says that he that puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom. But there is another thing that the Bible mentions actually fairly frequently, and it's about remembering. Those are two different things. Looking back and longing for things of the past, or remembering what God has done. Those are two different things. I want to start with that this morning. When the children of Israel were crossing the Jordan River, when Joshua was leading them, after Moses had departed off the scene, and they crossed the Jordan River, and the water stopped. We don't talk about that as much as we do about the Red Sea, but the same thing happened in the Jordan River. It was in a time of flood, and it was overflowing its banks. And God made the water stop. And they walked through that Jordan River. And they carried the ark through that Jordan River. And then Joshua said to 12 men, one at the head of each tribe, he said, pick up a stone. And actually, it was probably more like a boulder. And carry a stone out of that Jordan River. And when you get over here on the other side of the bank, you make that pile of stones and you pile it up. And then he said, and this is the reason. He said, in years to come, when your generations are growing up and you have children and grandchildren, they come and they say, what's this pile of stones? Then you can say, that's a remembrance of what God did and how he opened the Jordan River and brought us into this land of promise. That's a memorial. Bible says, actually, it's a memorial. It causes you to remember. Then I can go to 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy actually, chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. And Paul said to Timothy, wherefore I put thee in what? Remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but he's given us a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. And then he went on and said, if you go to the next verses, he says to Timothy, don't be ashamed of me and my bonds. And he also, there's a therefore in this verse. There are times, depending on situations, sometimes we get into situations and we get shaken around. There are times when we need to remember what God has done in our life in the past. That he has delivered us. And he has the power to deliver again. And Paul said here to Timothy, he said, there is something you need to stir up. There's a gift in you. There's something that's in you that God put on in you when I laid my hands on you. There is a gift in you, a gift of God. And now, Timothy, it's your responsibility to go and to stir that up. See, sometimes we want God to just do everything. But the very specific instruction that Paul gave to Timothy here is it's your responsibility to stir this up. The word stir there is the same meaning or is the meaning of when you're sitting around a campfire and you had a nice fire going and it was burning so well and then after a while it starts to consume the logs and it dies down and kind of gets down in its embers there. But you know, if you take a stick, a long stick, and you stir around in there, what happens? The flames come back up. And then you can add more logs to the fire. There are times in our lives that we need to take the initiative to stir something up. And if we just sit around and wait for God to stir us, it might be a while. You know something that stirs things up? Being with other believers. It stirs things up. I'm trying to stir you today. Being with other believers stirs up the gift that is in us. Times like we had in the fall in the conference, those are stirring times. But we're not always in those places. Sometimes we're out by ourselves. But it is possible to stir up things that are in you by reminding yourself of things that God has done in the past. By scripture, by reading, by prayer, by talking to another believer, maybe not in a church setting like this, but maybe on the job or meeting someone, and that spirit that's in us leaps. Those are all things that stir us. But sometimes we face things. And I'm not trying to say we don't, because I know we do. And David encouraged himself in the Lord. He got to a place where, this was a Ziglag, I think it was, the enemy had destroyed. See, we go through these times. I'm not trying to paint a picture where everything goes all right all the time, because that is not true. Things happen. The enemy comes sometimes and he takes things that are not his. This is what happened to David and his men. They had been out defeating the enemy in another place, and while they were gone, the enemy came in and took the stuff and the wives and the children, and they came back, and the men were upset at David because he said, "Our wives are gone, our children are gone." And they were ready almost to do harm to David. And it says that David encouraged himself in the Lord. Now, it doesn't go into specifics, but I'd like to think that what David did is he said, "I remember there was a giant by the name of Goliath. And I remember how big he was and how his words were. And I remember, Lord, the strength that I went in you and how that giant fell." And he encouraged himself by remembering what God had done in the past. Again, the Bible doesn't say that specifically, but he encouraged himself in the Lord. In the Lord. He encouraged himself. And then they went after the enemy, found the enemy, destroyed the enemy, and got all their stuff back, plus probably more. That's part of what it is to stir yourself up in the Lord. Remember what God has done in your life. He'll do it again, and he'll do more. Remembering. Part of the reason that I'm referring to that is because I'm going to, at some point here before too long, remember something that the Lord did in my life. Remembering is good. And I even think it's good when the Lord does something very special in your life to record it. Write it down. God is real. He does real things in our lives. And make a record of it. Now I'm going to speak a little bit about the difference between teaching and learning. Teaching and learning, and you might wonder, well, what are you getting to? And I'll read a verse here in Matthew chapter 11, 28 to 30. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." I've preached about this verse before, and some of the things, in fact, that I'm going to go through in this message are things that I've preached before. And somehow the Lord has had me on a certain course for a while here, and when he releases me from it, I guess I'll be through with that, or takes me into another area. But so I want to talk a little bit about rest, and I want to talk about teaching and learning, because teaching is important. And yet teaching will not learn you. That might sound strange to you. Teaching itself will not learn you. It will give you information, Jesus said here that we are to take a yoke on us and we are to learn of him. Teaching, someone can stand somewhere and tell you information. They can even tell you their experience. But that doesn't mean you know or have learned what you need to learn. In these times when they used oxen, they would yoke two oxen together. A yoke is a place where there is room for two. That's what a yoke is. You can't have a yoke for one, you have a yoke for two. And if they had a young ox that did not know how to pull the plow, they would take an older ox and put him on one side of the yoke, and they would put the young ox on the other side of the yoke. And the young ox would probably not like the yoke, would want to run away, but the old ox would keep him stable. And then they would take them out into the fields, and the young ox would learn how to plow, how to be useful, how to bear the yoke by walking with the old ox. And that is how they learned. Jesus says here, take my yoke upon you and learn. And the only way to learn Christ is to walk in his yoke. We read the Bible, and that's very, very important. And we read about Christ and about Jesus and about God the Father and about the miracles. But the life of a Christian is to be yoked with Christ and to walk down a road with him. It's not just to know about him or even what he did, but to surrender to his life, bringing our life under his life or to him and surrendering our life. It's the cross and saying, Lord, I want to walk with you. And in that walking with him and through the daily trials of life and the daily journeys of life and the daily things that we face, we learn Christ. Now, it's interesting to me here in this Matthew chapter 11, 28 verse. It talks about two kinds of rest. It says, Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. And part of that is referring to what they were under the law. But I believe that it can also refer to the burden of sin and guilt. And he said, come to me, I'll give you rest. And so I first found Christ in that exact way, that when I came to him, a burden of sin and guilt fell off of my shoulders. I remember it very clearly, that I had a freedom that I had never experienced ever before in my entire life. And I had a peace and a freedom that I didn't know was possible to have. Christ gave that to me. Now he says then right after that, he says, and take my yoke on you and learn of who I am. Learn of me. And then you shall find rest to your souls. I believe those are two different types of rest. I really do. One is a rest of the forgiveness of our sins, the freedom from guilt, the burden of guilt. And if you, for some reason, have not experienced that, come. Because there is peace and there is rest. But then there is another rest. Our souls are restless. And even after we find that forgiveness, we try so hard. We want to be so good. We want to do it so right. And we fail. And we learn that way that only is it by being under the authority and the will of God and finding his will and being willing to accept what God has and Jesus has for us that we find rest to our souls. And there is a rest to our souls. But finding that rest to our souls is a journey. It's the death of self-will, self-idea, self-strength, self-ability to find the ability of Christ. That doesn't happen in a day. It's a journey. That rest is a rest of position, of finding a place where we find that Christ is all in all. And we rest completely in His provision, in who He is and what He has done. It is the rest of position. That it is not who I am, not what I can do, not what I have done, not what I want to do. It is who He is. And being found in Him. So rest of position. By allowing our own things and our own self-will to continually go onto a cross. And there we find rest. It's the rest that a wife finds in her husband when she submits herself under his authority. Just a word about submission. Just a brief word. No one can make you submit. That is an act of your own self-will, or your own. That's an act of surrender of your own will. No one can make you submit. And if you say, as a woman, I just have to submit to my husband, you are not understanding submission. God never makes anybody submit to Him. He might bring circumstances, but He does not force us to do where we are not willing to bring ourselves under Him. He wants us. He wants our love. True submission is a man or a woman freely of their own accord saying, I have chosen to bring myself under this authority and form my life to that authority. Nobody can make you submit. And husbands, if you say, you have to submit to me, you are not understanding submission. And maybe not authority. So we choose to submit ourselves to God, to God's will, being yoked with Christ, walking with Christ. What a privilege. You see, submission is actually a privilege and an honor. That we can be submitted and yoked together with the Creator. That He desires us to be in partnership with Him. It's amazing. Submission is a privilege. Being yoked with Christ is a privilege. So we learn rest. We learn Christ, and we enter into His rest by learning it is what He does in us and through us, not what we can do ourselves. Some things only come through suffering, and it is part of how we learn Christ. I want to read a verse out of Hebrews chapter 5 here, verse 7 through 9. Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him, that was able to save him from death, was heard in that he feared. Though he were a son, yet he learned obedience. How? By the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. The Son of God Himself learned obedience. He was never disobedient. So you might wonder, well, how could He learn obedience? He was never disobedient. Christ was never disobedient to the will of God, ever. He was always perfectly obedient. But what He learned, He learned obedience through suffering. And I see that Christ came, was born into a human body, And in that human body, he needed a human body to experience suffering. He knew obedience, in a sense, but the obedience that brings pain and suffering and death, he learned to walk in an obedience when it meant suffering. Even the suffering of death, he learned obedience. When it was painful, when it wasn't easy, when it was hard. And then ultimately, he learned obedience when it meant complete end to his own flesh and his own human being. He remained faithful. He didn't think it was robbery to be equal with God. He humbled himself and was found in the form of a man. Now, there's different sufferings in life. To be a human being means to some degree that there's suffering. And it's because of sin. But there's different kinds of suffering in life. Sometimes we suffer because we do dumb stuff. We do things that we ought not to do because we don't think far enough. And we suffer the consequences. That's the law of sowing and reaping, in a sense. You drive too fast, and a cop pulls you over. Now, that's not very hard suffering, but the flesh sure doesn't like it. If you wouldn't have driven fast, you wouldn't have reaped the ticket. There are other things in life that happen that are outside of our control. Flat tires, people in our way, all kinds of things that happen. And we suffer to some degree. But there is another suffering that the Bible is speaking of here, and that is the suffering of when you choose right. You choose obedience. You choose to do the right thing. And people mock you for it. Or defame you for it. That's the obedience of, or the suffering of righteousness and for righteousness' sake. This is what Christ suffered. He did the right things. He was obedient to the Father. He did miracles. He spoke truth. And the religious world mocked him and rejected him and shamed him and bruised him and put him to death. That's the obedience or the suffering of righteousness. And that is the suffering that we find hard to accept. We understand suffering when we deserve it. We understand that really well. When we really do something wrong, and then we suffer the consequences, we're like, well, yeah, I messed up. But how about the times when you do something right and someone accuses you of doing something wrong? It is only by the Spirit of God that we can go through those times and, as Jesus did, say, forgive them. The choice lays before us when we come into those times. And we'll often choose obedience when there's no suffering. But what do we do when we know that there's suffering involved? And yet there are things we only learn through suffering. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed and shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Jesus suffered not only in the body, but he suffered the anguish of soul, the anguish of rejection, and in the end, the anguish of the rejection even of the Father. Really, I'm all just saying that to say this. There are some things that you only learn by suffering. And Job went through things where he said, in the last chapter of Job, he said like this. He said, I heard of you. I heard about you. I heard of you. But now my eye has seen you. Now my eye has seen you. You know, there's part of me that would like to say, I wish it wasn't like this, and yet there's another part of me that says, this is what it is to be yoked with Christ. Understand this. To be yoked with Christ means you're willing to go through suffering. It means you're willing to be misunderstood. It means you're willing to stand when no one else around you is standing. Some things are only learned by going through. I subscribed to this magazine. I think it's Christian History. And I was reading articles of men that have lived a long time ago, thousands of years ago, after the early church, but 1100 time. And one of them made this comment that it is only going through times where there's a really, really dark, he called it the night of the soul, that our will is really broken then. I wouldn't wish that on anybody. And yet it is true that God allows us to walk through valleys. In his loving kindness, in his desire for us to share his nature, he allows us to walk through deep, dark times so that we can truly know him. In Luke, he said, as he began his ministry here on earth, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, he said, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, and to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, and to set to liberty them that are bruised. And I love that verse. But the particular phrase here that I like is he came to heal the brokenhearted. And there are times in life that we come to. And the word brokenhearted, before I go there, the word brokenhearted means not just something that's broken in half, but the picture word of the word brokenhearted means dropping a beautiful vase and having it shattered into 1,000 pieces, where you look at it and you say, there's no way to put it back together. That's a picture of being brokenhearted. Now, you might think, we talk about being broken before the Lord and that we need brokenness before the Lord. But there is a brokenness that comes not by your own doing. And you hear there's a lot of talk about having your dreams fulfilled, about dreams that we have in life and how that God wants our dreams fulfilled and to go for what you want. And there's a lot of talk about those types of things. But for a man or a woman who is seeking after the heart of God, you will come to places where your dreams are shattered. And you look at it on the floor and you look at it and you're not sure what happened. And you're sure you messed up, and it's all your fault, or it's all somebody else's fault, and your joy of living is gone, and everything is dark and gloomy. And yet you know there's one you've had faith in and have faith in, who has saved you and has delivered you. And it is in those deep, dark times then God is luring us, Christ, and rest for our souls. When you come to a place you can't pull yourself out of, you know you're a Christian. And then God delivers you again. I don't quite know what to say about those times, because it seems to be in God's timing. I've walked through a place like that. I don't want to walk really through a place like that again. And yet I so appreciate what the Lord has done in my life. I don't know quite how to explain that to you, except the Lord heals the brokenhearted. And you look at something that you think that can never be mended, and he puts it back together. Somehow he puts it back together and he heals it, because when you're brokenhearted, you need healing. You need healing. You don't just need a quick fix for an answer to a problem. You need healing. I don't know. I hadn't really planned to go into all of that depth, but maybe you're in such a place of shatteredness. This is how we learn. This is how we learn. This is how we learn Christ. That's a little different picture from all of the hype and all of the pumped upness that sometimes we hear about. I'm just saying, this is how I've experienced Christ. And then out of that brokenness, he comes forth. He comes forth, not I, but him. And he heals the brokenhearted. And he sets to liberty them that are bruised. Those that have been bruised by something, and you're looking at that and saying, I'm never going to be able to. This happened to me. It's bruised me. Can I forgive the person who did it? The Lord sets you free from that. He'll set you at liberty so that you can move and live again. And it's his life. Or if you've lost sight of where you're at, he gives you sight again and he sets the captives free. So I went through a time like that back in 2021. It was after a number of things that had happened that I'm not going to go into detail with, but I had gotten to a place where my joy of living was gone. I thought probably my purpose for being here was probably over. I really did. And I thought, well, I'll continue to exist. I'll continue to live. I'll smile when I need to. I'll walk where I need to. But my joy was gone. But somehow the Lord in his mercy did speak to me. And out of that dry place, and it was a dry place, it was a dead place, it was a place of nothingness. Somehow he stirred my heart. And it was in the middle of that place, I lifted my hands and said, but God, I will yet praise you. I will yet praise you. I know you are. I don't know much else, but I know that you are. I know that you exist. I know you've changed my life. See, I was waiting for something that would motivate me until I came to that place where I simply, out of the dryness of nothing, I lifted my hand to God and said, I will yet praise you. And I thank the Lord for that. And I thank the Lord for that time. I want to speak now out of that. The Lord taught me something in that I want to go to now and speak about. And I've preached about this before, but I felt the desire or the need to bring it out here. Atmosphere. The importance of atmosphere. If you would go out on a space shuttle or up to the moon, you've seen pictures of this, and you would look back and you would see the Earth and all of its beauty, and you would see a ball, and you would see that it's surrounded by a layer of blue. It's a beautiful picture if you've ever seen it. And what you're seeing there is you're seeing the atmosphere around the Earth. And it is that atmosphere that gives you and I, that gives us the ability to breathe and to live. And if it wasn't for the atmosphere around the Earth and the way that God has created it, none of us would exist here. God made the Earth in a very tremendous way, and everything is so balanced. If it was a little further from the sun, it would be too cold. If it was a little closer, it would be too hot. But we're right in that perfect place. And we have the gravity that holds the oxygen in and the air in. And so we can exist here on this earth today, you and I. If it wasn't for that, of course, we wouldn't be here. And if that was gone, we would be gone in 5 minutes also. That's atmosphere. And it is that atmosphere that gives us the ability to live here and to walk here and to be human beings. And so environment, atmosphere is very important. The church here, the body of believers that's here, there is an environment here that we appreciate. We call it culture. Culture and environment and atmosphere are very close to the same thing. There is a culture that we have here. It's a culture of love. It's a culture that has come because of the Holy Spirit and God's love here. And we fellowship together, which invites the presence of God. In fact, the Bible says that where several brothers are and where they agree, it's a sweet smell. And that agreement is not just me saying, yes, I agree with you, but it is an agreement of spirit. Where our spirits are in agreement with each other, where there's no clash. It's a lot more than just saying, I agree with you. And there the Holy Spirit and God, God wants to be there. He loves that. That's what culture is about. You can have bad culture and you can have good culture. Environment and atmosphere. That's why Brother Arlen put this beautiful picture up here. And it's been up here before, but I love that picture. And of course, over here we have another picture. But that's a picture of Butchard Gardens out in Victoria, British Columbia, I think. It's a beautiful place. It invites something. And when you're there, it invites a worship of God. If you're a Christian, you look at it and say, these beautiful things that God has made. That invites a completely different type of being than that does over here. Over here in this beautiful garden, you would see butterflies, you would see honeybees, you would see hummingbirds going and finding sweet things and nectar and pollen and all those beautiful different things. And there's a peace and a serenity there in that garden. Over here, you have a desert. You have a lot of dead, dry things. There's a few growing things, but they're not flourishing. And that also invites certain things. That invites death. And if there would be a dead animal there, you would see probably turkey buzzards or some other kind of animal that feeds on trashy things. Two different environments, two different effects, two different things to look at. What invites you? Would you like to live there? Not particularly. Over here, I'd like to go back. It invites me. It's pleasant. It's beautiful. You can see that someone put thought into this. They put design in it. They put creativity into it. This is left to itself and it's barren and dry. Two different environments. Some things thrive in light, some things thrive in darkness. Why do you think the wickedness thrives in darkness? Righteousness is of the light. And you're willing to, if there's things in your life that you want to hide, there's a reason for it. You want to look at that, you want to examine that and say why. But if your life is an open book, it brings light in. Light does things that darkness will not do. Light is life. You might look at something. See, and these are things. You might look at something in your daily things of going about in your daily life, and you might say, well, what's wrong with it? Well, I will simply ask you this question: what presence does it invite? What culture or environment or atmosphere will it have in your life? To me, that's the question. We can lay out rules. We can say, don't watch this movie, don't watch that movie, don't go here, don't go there. But I'll ask you this question. What atmosphere is around it, and what will it introduce into your life? What atmosphere is in your home? Is it a place? Wives, pick on you first. Wives, is it a place? Do you make your place a home where the husband comes home and there's an inviting atmosphere for him when he comes home? Does he want to come home? What does he hear the first thing that he comes when he comes in the door? Is that how wrong things are? Is that how bad things are? And husbands, does your wife want you to come home? What atmosphere do you carry around you when you walk in the door? Are you complaining instantly about something that's not right? What atmosphere do we carry? That's the question, really. In our homes, in our businesses, what is the culture that is around us? I'll speak just a little bit more to this, especially in the context of homes, husbands and wives. We marry each other. It's been said like this. Men marry women thinking they'll never change and they'll just always be that young, perfect thing. Women marry men thinking they can change them. And they find out they stay the same. I don't know how much truth is in that, but what I want to say to that is this. We set out and we try to change each other, and I'm speaking now in the context of home, and we're sure that we know what's wrong with the other person and how they could be much better if they would just conform to our ideas. And so we use things. We use things to try to bring that about. We might use withdrawing ourselves for a while so they really start to appreciate us. Since it happened, I'll just back off. Now, see how you like that. Oh, that's really endearing. And we'll withhold love. Think of how silly this is. We withhold love to get love. It's foolish, but it is the self-life. Withholding love so we can get love. And we have an image in our mind of how another person ought to be. If we could just make them that way, then we could love them. Or we'll use fear. Men can use fear to beat their wives, not to submit, but finally give under because they don't want to deal with anger. And you don't have a submissive wife that way. You have one that simply is dominated. That's not love. We use guilt. Try to make a person guilty. Get them to do the right thing. These are all things that will build atmosphere and culture in your home that is not good. And we've probably all been guilty of some of that to some degree. And it doesn't work. You want something to grow. You want a good thing to grow? Water it. You want a bad thing to grow? Water it. You want something good to grow out of your home, out of your husband, out of your wife? Pour the water on what you want to grow. Find something where you can say, see, what this takes is death to self. The self can easily pick out the blame and the wrong and the judgment and all of that and look at that and say, if you were just this, God did not do that to you and me. He came and took the blame and he took the punishment and he took the sin and he took the blame so that we could live in his presence, in his culture, in his world. And he watered us and continues to water us. And he tells us in his word who we are in him. And he says, you were this, now you're this. You're my beloved sons. You were full of sin, now you're cleansed because my blood has cleansed you. Water that which you want to grow. And if you want chaos, confusion, bitterness, envy, then try to change each other and use fear and guilt and manipulation, and that's what you'll get. But if you will water and if you will appreciate and if you will love, there will be an atmosphere that invites the presence of God and invites you to each other. Yes, it takes laying down of self-life. The tongue has a tremendous amount in our lives of what makes culture and atmosphere, what comes out here. It is with this tongue that we bless, and it is with this tongue that we can curse. And James says these things ought not so to be. But our tongue should speak blessing, and blessing builds atmosphere. The right atmosphere, I should say. The tongue has a tremendous amount to do with that. I want to speak now about the culture of heaven. The culture of heaven. And to do that, I'm going to turn to Revelation chapter 4, and I'm going to read Revelation chapter 4. And then maybe a few other verses or through a couple other chapters yet. But I'm going to just read through the whole chapter here, Revelation chapter 4. After this is John on the Isle of Patmos. He was banned there. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit. And behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on that throne. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow around about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunders and voices. And there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, the second beast like a calf, the third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle, and the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about him. And they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fell down before him who sat on the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever. And they cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are, and they were created. I'm going to turn over to chapter 8, and I'm going to read verse 3 and 4. Another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer. And there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. Now, I'm going to turn actually a little backwards there. Revelation chapter 5 now, verse 11 through 14. And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels around about the throne and the beasts and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Verse 13, and every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such are in the sea and all that are in them, heard I saying, Blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. Somehow John, in his banishment, was there, and it says, and he was in the Spirit. And there was some kind of a door that was open. And I have to think that there's not all that much distance between us and heaven. Ezekiel saw very similar to what John saw. Daniel saw very similar, same thing. That God allowed them to see into another realm. And there's activity in heaven. There's a throne. And there's elders around that throne, and there's beings, and there's beasts. I don't understand all of that. I don't claim to understand it. But there is activity going on around the throne at this very moment. In a realm where we can't see currently, but we know by faith that these activities are going on, that constantly there are beings in God's presence and they're falling down before him. And the 24 elders are casting their crowns. When the beasts cry out, they cast their crowns. Crowns represent authority, and they cast them before the God Almighty, and they worship and they praise. This is the culture of heaven. And I can guarantee you right now that in heaven, everything is all right. God is on his throne. Jesus is at the right hand. And God is not up there, and he's not saying, I don't know what I'm going to do about 2024. No, it's all under his perfect control. And there's worship, and there's praise. And it says here in one of the verses that I read, that even the very creatures of earth cry out. The animals, all of everything that is made, cries out, Worthy are you, O Lord God Almighty, for you have made everything. Now, sinful man does not cry out that, but the redeemed ones do. And the ones that, the animal kingdom, all of it is groaning for that day of redemption where God will restore that which is broken completely. And he will come, and he is as the king of all. But right now in heaven, there's worship going on. This is the culture of heaven. It's activity. Now I want to speak to you. The title of my message today, which you might wonder, am I going to get to, is the garment of praise. The garment of praise. Because this is one of the things that God has taught me, learned me, I should say. That he has learned me in my difficult time. And I keep learning it as I walk with him. Specifically, praise It's worship and praise, but I want to speak specifically about praise today. Today we were gathered together here and we sang songs and our mouth opened up and we expressed. And I love the worship and the singing and the musical instruments, but I also like to be able to release my voice and sing along with the ones that are up here. It's an expression of my faith in God. But I want to speak about praise because there is a difference between worship and praise. Praise always, and I'll go through some things here. Praise always refers to an activity that we do with our mouth and with our hands. Worship is an attitude of the heart. When we come and we bow and we adore and we surrender and we lay, and we can worship without saying a word. We can worship in quietness. But when we praise, it comes out of our mouth. And lifting our hands is an act of praise. And we praise God. Now, I took the time to go through the Old Testament and the New Testament and look at all the different definitions of praise. And I'm just going to read them off here, the word praise, because there's a lot of different Hebrew words and a lot of different Greek words that are interpreted praise in the Bible. To praise means to revere and worship. It means to rejoice and to make a sound and to celebrate. It means to laud, which means to speak highly of another one. It means to congratulate. It means to boast and to make a show. It means to make music on an instrument with strings. It means to celebrate with a song. It means a confession of another one's greatness. It means to address in a loud tone. We want to shrink away from that, don't we? It means to speak of another one's fame. These are all words of praise. It means a story or a poem that exalts God. This is now the New Testament. It means to exalt the reputation of another one besides yourself. It means to commend. There's quite a number of people in here who like fine food, and I'm not against that. I've heard of a restaurant in Cleveland that I've never been to. It's been commended that I go there. This is what it means to commend. You recommend it. This is what God did in my life. I can commend you. Go to Him. Run to Him. Find Him. Repent of your sins. Let Him be your Savior. You commend Him. That is an act of praise. It is to sing a hymn. A hymn is a religious song that celebrates God and His mighty deeds. It is to give an offering of thanksgiving. All those things is the meaning of praise. Now let me read you something else. Murmur. The definition of murmur is a continual sound, a low sound of dissatisfaction. Grumble. To express dissatisfaction at one's conditions or circumstances. To find fault. Complain. The expression of dissatisfaction in a very negative way, usually directed towards another person. And overall, it means to stay in a place of discontent, obstinate, rebel, blamers, find fault, complainers. Atmosphere. One attracts one thing, one attracts another. David understood praise. He understood praise very well. More than, you know, there's about 250 instances of the word praise in the entire Bible. Out of those 250, 160 of them are in Psalms. David understood praise very well. And in fact, in one place, he appointed some of the Levites in 1 Chronicles 16. He appointed certain of the Levites to minister before the ark of the Lord and to record and to thank and praise the Lord God of Israel. There was two priests, Benai and Jehaziel, that their job was to continually be before the ark of the Lord with trumpets and to continually blow. That was their task. That's what they did. There was 4,000 other priests, Levites, whose task it was to constantly bring praise and rejoicing in the tabernacle or in the temple. I didn't realize that. 4,000. I don't know that it was all at one time, but that was their job. He said, David said in Psalm 34, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall be continually in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in thee, Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. And then in Psalm 42, he said like this, soul, why are you cast down? Why are you so disquieted? Hope in God. He spoke to himself out of his spirit, out of the inner man. He spoke to his own soul and he said, now soul, there is no reason to be so discouraged. That's quite something. And this is, I believe, how he encouraged himself in the Lord. I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. Oh my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore I will what? Remember from the land of Jordan of the Hermonites, from the hill of Marzar, things that God did there. Thy loving kindness is better than life. There's a ministry of praise that we are called to. And we do it, and we walk in it. And yet it is one thing to come together in church here when there's people beside us that smell nice and everything's going well, to say praise God and all that. But I'm talking about a ministry that God has called us to, every believer. A ministry that we join in what's going on in heaven, where they are continually praising God. God deserves all our praise continually, all the time. There's no question of that. And it's a privilege and an honor that God has called us to as his kings and priests, that on our lips, in Isaiah 43, he said, this people have I formed for myself. They shall show forth my praise. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. It was interesting to me as I read this and as I studied it. Why does it say the fruit of our lips? Fruit is what we call produce. It grows. But fruit comes from the interaction of two things, always does. Which takes me to Romans 12, chapter 1, or Romans 12, verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy unto God, acceptable unto him, which is your reasonable service. And we know about offering ourselves up. Well, what this speaks to me is this. We have surrendered to God, and he lives in our spirit, but our body needs to be come into submission to our spirit. And those two together, when the body is surrendered under the spirit man, and we speak the things of God, that is the fruit of our lips, giving honor to his name. And yes, we can worship and meditate, but the Lord wants us to take our bodies, and he wants us to lift our hands, which we do here. And he wants us to speak wherever we go, and he wants us to extol his glory and his name and give him praise and honor. I'm going to go now to the garment of praise. And that's in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 3. And it's out of the same passage where Jesus said, I have come to heal the brokenhearted. And it goes on down to verse 3, Isaiah chapter 61, verse 3. And he says like this, I have appointed unto them that mourn in Zion to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, and the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. Praise is a garment. And God has given us praise. He's also given us the oil of joy. He's also given us beauty for ashes. But he's given us the garment of praise. And it says he's appointed us unto this. It's an appointment. that you and I have as believers. See, in my business, I sometimes appoint people to do certain things. I say, okay, I might not use the word appoint, but that's what it is. I say, this is your specific spot, and this is what I want you to do. I appoint them to it. This is appointed unto us as believers to wear the garment of praise. Now, what does a garment do? It does three things. A garment, I have a garment on today, and I believe that you're all glad that I do. Am I right? See, a garment hides things. A garment covers up nakedness. Without the righteousness of God, all we have is our own self-righteousness, which is very ugly. And so we have Christ's righteousness. But we also have been given a garment that is called a garment of praise. And it goes hand in hand with the garment of righteousness. And it is a garment we can wear. I'll go on to the other things, and then we'll come back and talk about this. The other thing a garment does is it protects. When it's particularly cold outside, like it is this morning, we put some extra garments on because it protected us from elements that wanted to come against us. And then the third thing that a garment does is it identifies. A garment will tell you what someone is appointed to or what authority that they're under. If we would, I'll say this. I talked about speeding tickets. The other day, I had firsthand experience, except I didn't get a ticket. I only got a warning. So it's going a little fast on one of the back roads, and sure enough, I got pulled over. And the guy that walked up to my window, he had a certain uniform on. Now, if he wouldn't have, I would have questioned who he is. But he had a uniform on that said, Sheriff. And I knew right away, I knew how I identify him. Uh-oh, this guy does have the authority to give me a ticket. And so I was pretty nice to him. And he gave me a warning. I think because I'm finally mature. I didn't talk back. It was a long time learning that lesson. But I identified him immediately by the garment that he had on. I knew that he was under the authority of the sheriff. He was not the sheriff. He was the deputy of the sheriff. But he was under the authority of the sheriff because he had a garment on. And so praise is a garment that identifies you and I in the courts of heaven. That one place it says like this, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Back in the days when there was more kings, in England, in days gone by, it's not so much this way now, but in the days of I think it was King Edward, quite a number of years, probably back in the 1500s, somewhere like that, they would identify people by how expensive their clothing was. And if you did not meet a certain standard, you could not go into the court of the king. Poor people could not find entrance. If there was a party, they didn't necessarily send out invitations, but if you came and your clothes did not meet a certain standard, you were not allowed into the party. And there was people that almost made themselves bankrupt by having expensive garments. The garments that in today's dollars would cost $25,000, $30,000, but that's what they needed to enter into the presence of the king. It was an identification with the king. That's what a garment does. Now, Jesus has provided for us a garment of praise and is founded on the work that he has done. A garment covers, a garment protects, and a garment provides entrance and identification. You see that? It's atmosphere. It's important. If you want to enter into the courts, you have to be dressed right, or you won't have access. First of all, of course, the blood of Jesus washing our sins away. The Bible says a sacrifice of, or an offering of, or a sacrifice of praise. And at times we've talked about that as being times when it's hard to, because things are against us. But it also just means an offering. Yes, sometimes it's a sacrifice. It's always a sacrifice for the old man. There's always a reason that the old man can come up and say, it's not right to praise. I'll give you some reasons that the flesh speaks. I don't feel like it. Nowhere when I looked at praise did I find that it said, and when you feel like it, raise your hands and praise God. Or open your mouth. Nowhere, and as I looked, I didn't do an extensive search, but I didn't find it anywhere. So that's a reason that the flesh gives. Another reason is the circumstances are against me. Here's another reason. Someone has hurt me, and I prefer to dwell on that and not forgive them. Another reason is I have a sin that I have not confessed, and I'm guilty before God. And here's another reason that is very real to me, and I understand. I have made a mistake or a failure, and I don't think that I'm worthy even to wear the garment of praise. You see, the enemy wants to do everything to keep our mouth shut because praise is also a weapon against him. This is a truth. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty. Paul and Silas were in jail because they had delivered a girl of a demon. And the people that had charge of her didn't like it because they didn't get money anymore for her. So they threw them in jail, put their feet in the stocks, and there they were at midnight. And the Bible says they were singing hymns, and they were praising God, and the angel of the Lord came. You see, it was a weapon. And the angel of the Lord came and shook the prison and loosed them from their bonds. Circumstances will always in some manner be against you. Will that determine what your mouth comes out of your mouth? We will always have certain things that we made mistakes in, but you know what? God has provided for us in Jesus Christ through the blood, through confession of our sins, through apologizing, through forgiveness. And the enemy wants to tell you that you're not good enough to open your mouth and praise him, or it's not the right time, or it doesn't feel right. But what I have found, in the midst of darkness, in the midst of loneliness, in the midst of trial, that when I was willing to open my mouth and praise God, that things turned. Now that was what happened to me. I'm not saying that every situation that it'll be like that, but I do know that it's always right to praise God and that it makes a garment around you. And it will provide for you entrance. And it invites, the other thing that I see is this. Certain things are invited into this beautiful garden. You won't see them over here. There's things you see here that you won't see over here. And so when we surround, when we have the garment of praise, and we have the garment, God has provided it for us, but you can hang it on a nail and not use it. You have to put it on. You have to wear it. If it isn't that, all I'm saying up here is some words. You have to wear it. And by wearing it means you surround yourself with praise to God. Now, this is when your life is right. I'm not saying it's not some... Anyway, I'll leave that. And we walk in praise. And it repels things. And it invites. I believe that when we... Especially maybe when we're in hard times... And we open our mouth and we praise God that there's beings in heaven, that we're surrounded, and they look at that and say, look at that. Look at that. I want to be there. The Holy Spirit, that moves me. That man has faith in God. Even in the hard time, he still believes in God. I hear it from him. What comes out of our mouths is tremendously important. If the worship team would come up, I'll conclude with that. I went a little longer than I was going to. But, on the other hand, I started later than I was going to, too. To conclude with this, live in the constant awareness of heaven. We are, see, part of what faith is there is a veil around us. We don't see things. We don't see spiritual things. Not with these eyes. Live in the constant awareness of God and His presence. He's not far away. The Bible says that. He's as close as faith. Oh, that we could see how Elisha prayed for his servant. When his servant said, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? We're surrounded by enemy. What are we going to do? And Elisha prayed and he said, open the eyes of my servant. And suddenly he saw that they were surrounded by that around them was chariots of fire and fiery horses. His servant just didn't see them. But Elisha knew that they were there. Remember that to enter the royal court takes a robe of praise. Is your speech fitted for the royal courts? What environment are you walking in? What environment are you offering or inviting into your homes? This is a life-changing truth for me, and it's one of the reasons I shared it to you today and looking forward into 2024. And I've preached about it in different ways, but it has been a life-changing truth to me. You're facing a difficult, see, here's, we face difficult things, and I will not pretend that we don't, because we do. We face disappointment. We face disappointment in ourselves, disappointment in other people. We face things that we wish that weren't that way. And there we have an opportunity then. Are we going to focus on that problem and try to figure out a solution? And allow ourselves to be cast down? Or are we going to turn our eyes to the one who has all the answers and who has all power and all authority and begin to call on His name and begin to praise Him because of who He is, irregardless of your situation? But Lord, I praise You. Not trying to twist His arm to do something, but simply because it deserves our praise. And we turn our eyes away from our trouble and we put them on Him. And we worship Him and we praise Him. And it invites His presence. Let's go into 2024 knowing that God is bigger than any problem all the time. God bless you. It's been so good to. You helped me preach today. You pulled it out of me somehow. So God bless you for that. I'll turn the time over to the worship team.
Time.
of life, they get me down. When it seems I'm all alone, and I'm anything but strong, when I see that I can't make it on my own, I come running back to you, Jesus. You're the only
Thank you, Pastor Steve, for stirring up our souls. Steve mentioned taking a stick and prodding the embers, and I think he did that today, especially for me. But, you know, as Steve was preaching, I like the contrast, the picture that was put up here, because Steve talked about learning, the difference between being taught and being learned. You know, where I learned most of the things that I have learned was over here in the desert. And it's interesting that even Jesus, who was God and was fully man, before he began his earthly ministry, he went over here, and that's where he learned to do what was ahead of him. In fact, he learned it so well that he never went back there again. Now, what I've learned is sometimes I spend some time over here to learn some things. And if you really learn well, you don't have to go back there again to learn the same thing again. The only reason you go back there is because God sometimes has something deeper. You've learned this, now I have something more for you to learn. So let's go over here and spend some time there, and I will teach you. And I will learn you how to even go to greater heights, deeper depths. But you see, we can't really fully appreciate this until we've been here. If you've only seen that, it's not really that beautiful. The reason we enjoy summer and spring and fall is because of what we're experiencing right now. Winter isn't all that beautiful unless you really enjoy this. But we all know that this is just a season and eventually it'll change. But what I was found so interesting was that the garment of praise really applies whether you're over here or whether you're there. The garment of praise is to be worn wherever you are. And in fact, when you can praise Him when you're there, that is perhaps the highest form of worship that you can ever offer to the King. Because it's at a time when you don't feel like it. It's at a time when whatever dream or hope has been so crushed, in fact, that's what the desert's designed to do. It's designed to so crush it to a point where it's completely hopeless. If you can still find a little hope in it, then it probably hasn't been crushed enough. But when that happens and you can still raise your hands and you can praise Him and you can worship Him, then it's a good sign that you're learning whatever it is that God is trying to teach you when you're there. Amen. David finishes, I like how he ends the book of Psalms. He ends it by saying, praise the Lord, praise God in His sanctuary, praise Him in His mighty firmament, praise Him for His mighty acts, praise Him according to His excellent greatness. And then he says, this is how we're to praise Him. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet, praise Him with the lute and harp, praise Him with the timbrel and dance, praise Him with stringed instruments and flutes, praise Him with loud cymbals, praise Him with clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And it's just like Steve said, there's never a time. We are always to do praise. We are always to praise Him, regardless of what season we're in, whether we're in the winter or we're in the summer. We are to praise Him. We are to praise Him. So, amen. Thank you, Pastor Steve, for sharing with us today and bringing us the word. Let's pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Father, we thank You, Lord, that You are worthy to be praised. We know that You are good, that You have our best interest in mind, and that's why we can praise You. We can praise You because there is so much potential and life in You. And Lord, we know that when we praise You, especially in times of darkness, in times of need, in times of stress, in times of hopelessness, Lord, when we praise You, especially in those times, it invokes heaven. It stirs up heaven. And so I pray, Lord, that whether we're experiencing good times or whether we're experiencing the dark times, Lord, that You would give us the courage. Maybe it's just a feeble hand. That's all the strength we have. Maybe that's all that we have. But just that outstretched arm, that outstretched hand of praise to You, Lord, all of that is seen by You. You see every heart. You see every hand. You see everyone that praises You. And Lord, it gives us the confidence to continue on. And so, Lord, may this become a part of our DNA, our fabric that's woven within us to continually wear that garment of praise. And thank You again so much for giving us a reason to praise and worship You. We thank You and bless You, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you're dismissed.